legal, foi.
Hebrews 13, 17, prophets on the scene, wash your souls clean before we go into the gasoline. Took a while to understand, Psalms 111:10, brother calling me from Mississippi trying to build a man. I flushed 14 grams, it made angels rejoice, it made me and Satan divorce, no spousal support. I'm running the course with my hand to the plow,
now
putting in the pebble the way Soldier James taught me how.
Break it out,
it strengthened my spirit when we in the building. Ain't no feeling like giving a precept for a precept giving.
Reach
MOV conditions.
Teach
self a second living.
We
2 Timothy 2:15 representatives.
Jeez.
World of common interest. Prophesy to the wind. Rebuild the man of sin. Enduring to the end.
We watch the watchmen for Israel. Cause we watch it for Israel. We the watchmen for Israel. Cause we watch it for Israel. We the watchmen for Israel. Cause we watch it for Israel. We the watchmen for Israel. Cause we watch it for Israel.
Hey, shalom, shalom. You are tuning in live to the Watchman Radio, the decree of the watchers. I am Officer Simakaya.
Officer Asa.
Officer Yoganon.
Officer Ariel.
So today on this episode, we're going to dive into the PJs or the projects. It's going to be a couple of episodes on dealing with this subject. But that's what we're going to deal with. We're going to open up with Isaiah chapter 62 and verse 6. Isaiah chapter 62 and verse 6.
Isaiah chapter 62 and verse 6.
Freedom.
I have set watchmen upon thy walls, O Jerusalem, which shall never hold their peace day nor night. Ye that make mention of the Lord, keep not silence.
So as you're tuning in to the Watchman Radio, we are the watchmen.
That's right.
Jerusalem is you blacks, Hispanics, and Native Americans. So what we're doing, we're going through the various things that go on in our community and showing you why they are how they are and the solution to get up out of those ways.
That's
we are
right.
The watchmen, and our job is to show you what's wrong so we can get right. Read.
Verse 7, and give him no rest till he establish, until he make Jerusalem a praise in the earth.
And we're not going to rest as we bring these things out until our nation rises back up to how we're supposed to be.
That's
right. Our goal. That's right. Our aim. That's our purpose. So from there, go to Romans chapter 15 and verse 4. Because we have to understand, what you have to understand is that this Bible has not been taught to us as a people over the years how it's supposed to have been taught. That's why our neighborhoods are in shambles. That's why we're living in the slums. That's why we're living in the ghettos. That's why we're living in the PJs. Read.
Romans chapter 15 and verse 4.
Freedom.
For whatsoever things were written aforetime were written for our learning.
So this Bible that we have, the Old Testament, the Apocrypha, the New Testament, these are the things that was written aforetime for us to read about the history of David, read about the history of Solomon,
right?
Read about the history of Samuel, so we can see the things that they did right and learn from it, and to see the things that they may have did wrong and learn from it. Either way, these scriptures was written for us to learn from and govern our lives accordingly. Read.
That we, through patience and comfort of the scriptures, might have hope.
And it's us going into these scriptures that's going to give us patience and comfort, because we're going to see our beginning. We're going to see the times that we're in right now. We're going to see our end. And as we change our lives for the better, we're going to have that patience and comfort because we know what's to come. Go to Isaiah chapter 46 and verse 9. Because what we have to understand is the people, the Bible is a black history book.
Right.
And what we've been taught over the years that it's a white man's book. But what we're here to tell you is that, no, it's a black man's book because all our history is contained in it.
Bring it out.
Read.
Isaiah 46 and verse 9.
Freedom.
Remember the former things of old.
So the Bible instructs us, the Most High let us know, to remember the former things of old. How else are we going to remember the former things of old unless we have our records, when we know what our records are? Other than that, farthest back, most of us can look at slavery. Or the farthest back, some of us can look, sadly, is the 60s, the Black Panther movement, things like that.
Yep.
We have to know who we are. We got to know that in this Bible contains the former things of old. Read.
For I am God, and there is none else.
Because the Most High, let it be known. It's only he's God, and there is none else. He is God, and there is none else. Read.
I am God, and there is none like me.
Uh-huh. There's no God like our God. There's no God like our God, meaning what? He's able to preserve his people, and he's able to preserve instructions for his people to once they recognize, hey, I'm going in the wrong path. And he's able to direct. He was able to preserve his word so that we can look back to it, come to an understanding. The prophets out here bringing the word out, and we're able to come to it, come to an understanding, and return to our God and do what he required us to do. Read.
Declaring the end from the beginning.
And he declared the end from the beginning. So in this Bible, we see the beginning, the midst of times, and the present. And he declared it all long before any of us was born. He declared the end from the beginning. Read.
And from ancient times, the things that are not yet done.
So the things that we don't even know is to come yet is written in this Bible. Read.
Saying, my counsel shall stand, and I will do all my pleasure.
Basically saying that everything that the Most High put in this Bible is going to come to pass. Some things have already come to pass, like us going into slavery, us living in these hard, harsh conditions. These are all curses. These are all things that we're going through because we turned our back on our God. So now our job is to show you the various things that's going on in our communities, show you how to relate to the Bible, and show you what we can do to actually fix these things, because marching ain't gonna fix nothing, just like we've seen over the years.
Voting,
getting into politics, ain't none of that stuff gonna fix our community, because we tried all of it. Even the cultural, having a cultural center, that's not gonna fix the community, because there's millions of those in our community. So this is what we have to understand and know. But right now, we're going to jump into the topic. We're going to deal with the projects. And this is going to be like an intro to probably a 2 or 3 part series dealing with the projects, because it's a lot of information that's out there. A lot of us may not even know. Let's pull up that first article on the CHA.
Blow it up, y'all.
Chicago Housing Authority. The initial goal of public housing was to provide decent housing for poor and low-income households. There have been two categories of public housing in Chicago, for families and for the elderly. Founded in 1937, the Chicago Housing Authority, CHA, has been responsible for all public housing in the city of Chicago. It is a municipal, not-for-profit corporation governed by commissioners who are appointed by the mayor. Social former Elizabeth Wood was CHA's first executive secretary, serving with distinction until 1954.
Now go back up. All the highlighted part,
yep.
The racial segregation embodied these developments was in compliance with federal policy, the neighborhood composition rule, which required that the tenants of a housing development be of the same race as the people of the area in which it was located. Managers were selective in choosing among the thousands of families who applied for apartments. There had to be one employed breadwinner, and the tenants had to behave according to prescribed rules.
So wait a minute. So it was already a racial separation right there, because they was going based on race, right?
Right.
Mm.
Yep.
Abandoning the neighborhood composition rule, CHA introduced a short-lived policy of racial integration, which precipitated a series of violent white-black confrontations.
Basically saying, let me read all of it. It's basically showing that in the beginning, they actually had blacks and whites intermixed in these projects. But basically, all it resulted in was racial
violence.
Right.
Say it again.
Racial violence.
Right, racial violence. So then they changed it up again. Now read this.
Hey, before you go even farther, reading up when we first started reading. Go all the way up. All the way up, all the way up, all the way up. All the way up. Right. It says, the initial goal of public housing was to provide decent housing for poor and low-income households. That sounds good on the surface, but we understand that we dealing with the devil. The devil is the greatest deceiver, period. And the Lord told us, never trust your enemies. We keep trying to integrate into a system that does not have our best interests at heart. And on paper, they write the most beautiful, well-intending things. But behind the scenes and then the actual action or the rolling out of the plan is nothing like what they wrote. But then when you, in hindsight, look at it, you'd be like, they set us up for the for failure. We never really trust in the Lord. The Lord tried to tell us time and time again, follow my rules. Because if you don't, there's a devil out there waiting to devour you. That's why the scriptures tell you to stay sober. Be vigilant. What we're doing right now as the watchman, we're imparting upon you the spirit of the Lord so you can be vigilant as well. You could be a watchman as well. You could do this research yourself. We're not making this stuff up. There was a plot to relegate us to a specific areas in the Chicago neighborhoods.
Right.
We remember, we ran from Mississippi. A lot of our mothers and fathers, their grandparents ran from Mississippi.
That's why it was founded in 1937, that great migration period. Right?
Absolutely. They ran from Mississippi running from the racial segregation that was going on down there. And they came up here thinking it was going to be better, but it wasn't. It was the same. All they did was learn how to use the pen to keep you away from them. But what we want to do is we want to show everybody the love of God. Like, we can all get along. We can't all get along, period. That's just not within our nature. We two different manners of people, as it says in Genesis. But go ahead.
And then when you read, you know, just to that point, and when you read more in the article, I don't think it's in the highlighted parts, but it talks about how the housing was made for war veterans when they came back.
Okay.
But as we go through it, you're gonna see how eventually it actually came to the surface. They real intent with these
projects.
Read on.
After 1950. Public housing began rapidly to deteriorate.
So that's right there. That's now it began to rapidly deteriorate because we was there. It was all us.
That's a plan. That's called benign neglect.
Right. So read on.
Some buildings had serious design flaws.
Wait, minor design flaws.
Serious design flaws. All buildings were subject to hard use and were badly maintained.
Man, if I point out some,
go ahead.
Bring it up.
Everybody.
The elevators?
The elevators.
Yeah.
That's the first thing come to your mind. Even if you stepped foot in them, you knew how the elevators was. You used to be scared to get on them. Even if you was visiting somebody, the elevators would jump. Yeah. You would think they finna drop down. You finna die in there.
The doors open up at half level of the floor.
Yep.
You open it up and at your face, you see the floor. Come on, man. We ain't getting there. We ain't doing it. We not doing it.
And most of these projects.
No, I was finna point this out too.
Yeah, yeah.
If y'all look up the documentary on the Cabrini Green, you had people, apartments flooded. They were standing in water. No heat. They in the house cutting the stove on like, people will say these things is not safe.
Wait, when their apartments flooded, was they on the first floor or the basement?
Nope.
Damn.
Wait, so wasn't on the first floor.
On the 14th floor.
Yep.
Damn.
Yep. So when this says this, y'all know that's not a lie. I'm talking about those of us that's from Chicago. I don't care what side you on. You stay on any of them projects, in them projects.
Or visited.
Or visit. You knew it was like this. Urine everywhere, feces everywhere.
Yeah.
Stuff broke down in there, and it never got fixed. And guess what? This same behavior to the projects was in the apartment complexes.
Yeah. Right.
Same stuff.
Some of these projects, they're at least like over 10 stories high. So imagine if the elevator break down, now you got to walk up or down a flight of stairs with you.
Or an emergency happen, and you need immediate emergency medical attention, or a fire happen.
Right.
services got to go up. I think, if I'm not mistaken, I read somewhere where the fire department, if they got called out to a scene where it was more than 14 floors, they'll take their time getting there. It's a chore to get up and down them stairs with all that equipment on, with the elevators not working. So we were neglected in the services that our tax dollars paid for.
Yeah, even with the elevators, with that, and I think it might be on one of the articles today, or maybe something we cover in the next week. But it said, I read one of them where when the elevators was down, they was even scared to go up the stairs because the stairway was dark.
Mm.
So it was a catch 22 no matter which way you went.
Damn.
Go ahead, officer.
Go ahead.
You got some more now.
All buildings were subject to hard use and were badly maintained, which accelerated their deterioration. CHA managers stopped screening applicants and the socioeconomic mix of tenants changed as the CHA was directed to accommodate all families who had been displaced by urban renewal expressway construction.
I-290, Eisenhower Expressway, what else? 9094.
Yep.
They ran them right through our neighborhoods. Most cities that you go to, a lot of the infrastructure that is needed to house or to have the expressways, it was our neighborhoods. They would, if it came down to Esau's neighborhood, they would try their best to go around it or just go somewhere else altogether. But for us, they didn't care. They ran right through our neighborhoods, tearing up multiple blocks at a time, doing so, displacing many families.
And what they use the term eminent domain. Which
absolutely.
Nigga, you got to move.
Absolutely.
This the stuff you don't know. You know what this is? It's called covert racism.
Absolutely.
Covert racism.
Drop a bomb again.
Is when they do things in your face, but like the officers is saying on the points they was making on this, is done under your nose. They do it with the pen. This is a segregated city. Even these systems that's set in place here is segregated. Is racism involved in this? If you look up the percentage of people that deal with CHA, it's our people.
Give me Psalms 55 and 21.
Can't trust that man.
You can't trust this man for nothing when you got to go ahead and read it. Because my officer, he said that this covert racism, it's not overtly known or widely known until you, with a fine microscope and in your right mind, look into it with spiritual eyes. You'll be able to see that, man, this is racism. This is hatred. This is a war tactic. Read.
Psalms chapter 55 and verse 21.
Go ahead.
The words of his mouth were smoother than butter, but war was in his heart. His words were softer than oil. Yet were they drawn swords.
He spoke nicely. He spoke peaceably. He said that this was for a good cause, making these houses the way they were made. And yes, it was. But all he had to do was neglect the services. All he had to do was cut back on the stringent criteria for getting good families in there. That's all he had to do. He made provisions for that to actually take place because it's a war tactic. That's why it says, yet they were drawing swords and war was in his heart. We can't trust this enemy. You have to know who your enemy is and understand that the Lord said, do not trust him.
The devil. Got some more on that, officer.
No, we could go back to the article.
I'm finished.
We had the second paragraph, right?
Yeah. After
about the late 1950s.
By the late 1950s, it was apparent that were serious physical problems and the high-rise projects. Nonetheless, CHA continued to build high-rise projects in black districts until 1968, when the federal government stopped funding high-rise buildings for family housing. All told, CHA built 168 high-rise buildings with approximately 19,700 apartments for families.
Next point.
Just keep reading.
In 1966, a group of tenants sued the CHA, alleging that the agency was perpetrating racial segregation by citing projects in the ghetto.
So,
what the
hell is this? So, anytime you see that word alleging, that's some BS. So they're saying that the tenants was alleging. We just read in the previous paragraph that the projects were deteriorating and not getting the maintenance that they needed to get. But now you're saying that somebody sued and they alleged. This article is written after all this stuff happened.
The hell is this?
So it's no longer an allegation. It's facts.
Facts.
It might have happened.
Right.
It could have happened.
Because if it didn't happen, the buildings would still be standing, right?
Right.
Absolutely.
Come on.
The government would have continued funding it because they would have seen that this was a great program.
Right. Right.
But they got to cut off the tail when they start figuring out, hey, they're catching on to what's going on. We have to actually look like we're against this. So that's why they stopped it.
So let's read that real quick in Ciroc.
Hide the evidence.
The officer mentioned he quoted it earlier, but let's just go ahead and read it. Ciroc 12 and 10.
He said, hide the evidence.
That's what they do. When people know they finna get caught, dump everything. Throw it away.
Swallow. Eat it.
Say, tie up the loose ends.
That's it. Absolutely.
The book of Ciroc, chapter 12 and verse 10. Never trust thine enemy, for like his iron rusted, so is his wickedness.
So even when you're researching these articles and you're researching stuff like this, you can't trust everything that you're reading.
Right.
Because they're gonna water it down and make it look like they cared and they gave a damn, and they didn't. Because a lot of it's one of the videos, I don't think we're going to go to it today, but it's one of the videos where they always set one of the political people or the alderman or whatever, they always send either the black woman or they put a black man up there to speak for them so that it don't look like it's them. It look like it's our own people turning us against each other.
Damn puppet.
Read on. Read verse 11.
Verse 11. Though he humble himself and go crouching, yet take good heed and beware of him. And thou shalt be unto him as if thou hast wiped a looking glass. And thou shalt know that his rust hath not been altogether wiped away.
No matter how shiny he look, no matter how shiny of a suit he come and present something to you in.
What they say, he had knight in shining armor.
The devil. He's no matter how good or what type of proposition he come with, no matter how good it sound, that rust gonna eventually show back up on that metal.
Hey.
Read on.
Set him not by thee.
It says set him not by thee. Don't trust him. Don't shake hands with him. Don't sign under his paperwork. Don't do nothing with him. Read.
Lest when he hath overthrown thee.
When he done displaced you out your home.
Damn.
He stand up in thy place.
Damn. Then he gonna build up in the place that he took from you. And that's what we see. What we talking about, I don't think it said it yet, but Cabrini Greens is one of the ones. He tore it all down, and now it's like two buildings left, but it's all of them all around it. Read.
Neither let him sit at thy right hand, lest he seek to take thy seat. And thou at the last remember my words and be pricked therewith.
Meaning you didn't listen to the advice that was given and you trusted him. And then when he bit you, when a snake bit you, you look like, man, I should have listened. But it's too late. But let's go back to the article. We got to move on.
In 1966.
Hey, you from Chicago?
Yes, sir.
I'm going to gauge and determine it by how you pronounce this next word.
Uh-oh.
In 1966, a group of tenants sued the CHA, alleging that the agency was perpetuating racial segregation by citing projects in the ghetto.
Now you got him being super careful as he read.
Go ahead.
And Gautreaux versus Chicago Housing Authority.
He had a good education. Gautreaux. He said that nice. I don't know if that's how you pronounce it, but you said it good.
I think the X is silent, though.
Like it's guttural?
Right.
Sounds
better.
A federal judge enjoined CHA from building additional family housing in black residential areas. He ordered the agency to build scattered site housing elsewhere in the city. Thereafter, the authority built no more than a handful of scattered site dwellings. Following the Guthrie Act's decision, almost all of the housing built by CHA was for elderly tenants, housing that could be built in white sections of the city. CHA erected its first project for the elderly in 1959. In between 1961 and 1976, the CHA built 46 developments, totaling 9,607 units. Family high-rise projects continued to exhibit social problems, and the buildings continued to deteriorate. In 1996, the Federal Department of Housing and Urban Development, HUD, took control of the CHA on the grounds of mismanagement and poor performance. At about the same time, HUD introduced a radical change of policy, advocating demolition of failed high-rise buildings. Chicago demolished several high-rise buildings in 1996 and 1997, planning to redevelop those areas with a mix of public housing and housing for middle-income households. The CHA regained control from the federal government as it undertook continued demolition and redevelopment.
And one thing on that point, I'm going to be quick. That's exactly what it is. Because when you go over there where Cabrini Green is, and those of y'all who from Chicago and you live in Chicago, or you come back and forth to visit family, you know where the Cabrini Greens is, who live there predominantly. You got that last standing of those row houses.
Yep.
And then the rest of it is a Jewel, Osco, it's a bunch of stores.
Bike lanes.
That's other nations that live there, other races of people that live there.
Right. There's only like one block that people actually still live in. Mm. And then the other buildings, did they tear them down yet?
I think they just gated up. Right?
They gated it up and boarded up. But the buildings are still there, but they just there sitting. Mm. You just want to say something, officer?
No, I was about to add too. Like, you built all these stores, like, and they got the Apple store right there on the corner.
Right.
Damn Apple store. Who is that for? That ain't for us. Go ahead, officer.
Yeah. So pull up the definition of ghetto.
Ghettos, a quarter of a city in which Jews were formerly required to live.
It's going to be all right.
Read all three of them.
An isolated group.
No, go back up.
Go back up.
We ain't read number two.
Number two, a quarter of a city in which members of a minority group live, especially because of social, legal, or economic pressure.
Can you say that word?
Why number one, though? What's number one going
on? Right, I think we skimmed through that part right there. Mm-hmm. We can't skim through number one. Read that again.
I remember being young. Y'all ain't got to turn the camera. I remember being young, and my mom knew that definition. She was like, the ghetto is where the Jews dwell. Right? So this been known, but how come it's been hidden from us? You know?
Hidden in plain sight.
It's hidden in plain sight.
Covert racism.
A quarter of a city in which Jews were formerly required to live. An isolated group. A situation that resembles a ghetto, especially in conferring inferior status or limiting opportunity.
Wait. Can you enunciate that? Can we put some emphasis on that word?
A situation that resembles a ghetto, especially in conferring inferior status or limiting opportunity.
Who got the inferior status?
Our people.
Right.
So our people. So just based on that definition, it says that resembles a ghetto, especially in conferring inferior status or limiting opportunity.
Uh-huh.
Let's go to Deuteronomy 28. Deuteronomy chapter 28 and verse 15. Because we want to show, like we said, that our purpose is to show you, as we're going through this information, we're showing you how it relates to us and how it relates to us in the Bible. Our history reflects the Bible 100%. But we have not known that because our Christian pastors has failed us all our lives. We done went through church after church, and all you did was learn how to dance and hoot and holler and two-step.
That's it.
So we going to show you what the scriptures actually say. Deuteronomy 28 and 15.
Then Deuteronomy. Deuteronomy chapter 28, verse 15. But it shall come to pass, if thou would not hearken unto the voice of the Lord thy God, to observe to do all his commandments and his statutes, which I command thee this day, that all these curses shall come upon thee and overtake thee.
So as we read in here, we know that Moses is writing this to the Israelites. So we know that the Israelites is us. He's writing to us. This is us. This is our forefathers that we're reading about. He said, if you break God's commandments or break God's rules, then these curses or bad things are going to come upon you. Let's jump up to 43.
Verse 43. The stranger that is within thee shall get up above thee very high.
The stranger is the other nations. It says the stranger that is within thee shall get up above thee very high. Who's reigning over us? All the nations, every nation we got, we got a neighborhood, but the corner store you go to, the Arabs own it. The grocery stores in your neighborhood, the white man own it.
Beauty supply.
The beauty supply. The Japanese or Chinese own it. Every business that's in our community, we don't own it. We at the bottom. We go and spend our money with them, and that money never come back into our neighborhood.
Hey, officer. We can't forget some of the buildings that our people stay in.
Yep.
Amalek, the fake Jews, own those buildings.
Yep. So read on.
And thou shalt come down very low.
And thou shalt come down very low, or be in an inferior status, or having limited opportunities. Read.
He shall lend to thee, and thou shalt not lend to him.
When we want to get a mortgage, we got to go to our enemy to get that loan. When we want to rent a, we want to rent an apartment, we got to go to our enemy. We want to get a low-income apartment, we got to go through our enemy. Section 8, we got to go and apply and wait on a waiting list to be able to get housing based on our inferior status, and we can pay based on how much we make a week.
And you know what's so heavy about this? Because I can't help with this definition. It says conferring inferior status and limited opportunity, right? Because they create these conditions, right?
Right.
Because it's supposed to be for housing for us, but like you mentioned before, it's all the trap, right? Mm-hmm. So they create the conditions in these projects intentionally, right?
Yep.
And then it gets you in that stigma that, hey, I got to get out these projects. And what you do when you got the projects, you forget about your people.
Yep. Hey, the projects were successful at showing us the Negro can't make it without God. Can I get Deuteronomy 4 and 6 real quick? The Negro, if you give him anything, he ain't going to take care of it. He ain't going to respect it.
Man.
He going to run it down into the ground.
Right. Yep.
Imagine the Lord giving the world to a Negro, saying, you in charge. Right. Run this earth how it need to be run so it could continue on. This thing will last 24 minutes.
Right.
They going to drop that. All type of big guns, big nukes. They going to destroy everybody, block who they ops with. And guess what they not going to do?
Right.
They not going to rationally make this thing last. Go ahead and read that.
And then like you stated before, this housing project, it creates that culture.
It does.
It creates a whole culture.
It does.
We about to read it right now, right?
You magnified and you glorified in your rap music. They make movies about it, glorifying it. They do all sorts of things. They even made Candyman, the monster of the projects.
Right.
Because that's the spirit that's in the projects. Monsters dwell in the projects. You read about that in what, Isaiah 3 and 12?
Or
2nd Ezra 5 and 8?
Yeah. All that,
You read about these monsters, these people embodying the spirits of monsters. But let's read.
Deuteronomy chapter 4 and verse 6.
Uh-huh.
Keep therefore and do them, for this is your wisdom and your understanding.
Read 5 and 6.
Verse 5. Behold, I have taught you statutes and judgments, even as the Lord my God commanded me, that ye should do so in the land whether ye go to possess it.
Wherever we go to possess it. Back then in this time, we were going into the land of Israel that would be called Israel, which was the land of Canaan. Wherever we go, it don't matter if it's today or tomorrow. These statutes we should keep with us so that we can possess in righteousness our dwelling. Read.
Keep therefore and do them.
Keep these commandments and do them. Go ahead.
For this is your wisdom and your understanding in the sight of the nation, which shall hear all these statutes and say, surely this great nation is a wise and understanding people.
We ain't keeping these laws to impress nobody.
That's right.
We keeping these laws to show who our God is. That's to show you can't come against what the Lord built.
Right.
Surely if this nation is keeping these laws, we can't come against them.
Right.
Surely if they keeping these laws, they God going to defend them.
Right.
But that we're not keeping these laws and we showed it out that we're vulnerable. And we've shown, the project shown that we're vulnerable as Negroes. So it did a successful job at exposing us outside of the laws of God. That's all I wanted to add.
Yep. So let's pull up that next article on Cabrini Green.
Hey, officer, you mind if I get a quick scripture on that?
Go ahead.
What's happening right now? Because some people might be like, okay, why y'all touching on this topic? It's the spirit of the Lord. Yisroch 42 and verse 19. Saying the same thing as Isaiah 46 and 10, what the officer had brought out. See, our enemies thought that these things would stay secret.
Yes.
They thought none of this stuff would ever come to light.
Right.
Some of y'all that's in the Midwest, specifically Chicago, you think that it's no racism here.
Right.
But what's happening? Read.
Ecclesiasticus chapter 42, verse 19.
Read.
He declareth the things that are past.
That's what the Most High does. He declares the things that are past. He know the end from the beginning. Read.
And for to come.
Uh-huh.
And revealeth the steps of hidden things.
That's what's happening right now.
That's right.
The Most High put it on the spirit of the prophets to reveal these hidden things. Because while you walking around, you'll think because you see downtown and all this other stuff, nothing happens here. Nobody's plotting on us. Nobody's trying to keep us at the bottom or keep us in certain areas until it gets revealed. So listen, pay attention. This is stuff they don't teach you in school. Go ahead, officer.
So pull up the Cabrini Green. Let's read through this. Let's try to read through kind of quick.
Cabrini Green, neighborhood in the near north. Community area, formerly Swede Town, in the Little Hell, the site of the Cabrini.
And then Little Hell,
the site of the Cabrini Green public housing
y'all
complex
up a little bit.
Was notorious in the earlier 20th century for its inhabitants' poverty and dilapidated buildings.
Dilapidated buildings. Yeah, Chicago public school system. All praises. Yes. All praises.
During World War II, the Chicago Housing Authority raised Little Hell and built a low-rise apartment project for war workers.
So they raised Little Hell, meaning they destroyed it, but they leveled it. Like they said, for Jerusalem, raise it. They right. made it come down.
So I want though, because this article, it says Little Hell, but it don't tell you why it was called Little Hell.
Bring it out.
So just remember that. It says it raised Little, so they destroyed Little Hell, and there's a reason why they destroyed it. It's a video that we're going to look in that's going to explain it in a little bit more detail on why they called it Little Hell.
Bring it out.
Read on.
And built a low-rise apartment project for war workers, naming it Francis Cabrini Homes, after the first American canonized by the Catholic Church. CHA further transformed the area with the high-rise Cabrini Extension, 1958, and William Green Homes, 1962. The original population of Cabrini Green reflected the area's prior ethnic race. Poor Italians, Irish, Puerto Ricans, and African Americans lived among the war workers and veterans. Racial segregation overtook Cabrini Green by the early 1960s. The large new apartments and large swaths of recreation space failed to mend the area's poverty. The difficulty blacks had finding better, affordable housing gave Cabrini Green a permanent population. CHA failed to budget money to repair buildings and maintain landscaping as they deteriorated. Cabrini Green's reputation for crime and gangs rivaled Little Hells.
Rivaled
Little Hells.
So just pay, that's another point. I just pay attention. It said Cabrini Green's reputation for crime and gangs rivaled Little Hells. So it was in competition with Little Hills, which is what was there before Cabrini Green got there.
Everybody know Cabrini Green. Nobody knows Little Hill.
Right.
So if you know Cabrini Green to be what you know it to be, Little Hill is the same.
So go ahead.
The murders of two white police officers in 1970 and of 7-year-old resident Dentrell Davis in 1992 drew national attention.
All right, we could drop that. We could skip that last paragraph. Let's pull up that video. Why Chicago's worst public housing project became a national disgrace.
Bring it out.
I never heard of Little Hell.
Yeah, I never heard of it either.
Me neither. Get them bombs ready, y'all. Them bombs ready.
Little Hell.
In the early 1900s, there was a group of immigrants, many of them Italian, but also Irish and Swedish, who settled around Goose Island. They came to work in dirty, challenging, and often low-paying jobs in the steel mills and the gas works on Goose Island, where tall stacks belch flames and smoke that could be seen miles away. Well, some called the area Little Sicily for its large number of Italians. It was also called Little Hell for the smokestacks and the crime that plagued its residents. One Chicago Tribune article called the area around Little Hell, quote, the most dangerous neighborhood in the city. The name arose after a series of murders.
So it said this the area was called the most dangerous neighborhood in the city. But we wasn't there.
Can we drop
it,
a bomb?
It was Italians.
That's why we never heard of Little Hell.
Exactly. And then if y'all remember, a few episodes back, we talked about the gang history.
Right.
And it was Esau. But they don't highlight that. They try to highlight our issue. But the thing about it is, we go through what we go through because we broke God's commandments.
Right.
So we got a spirit on us because the Most High is disciplining us. That's just their spirit. Just
bring it out.
That's just how they are. Just like they stole this land, they stole the whole damn earth. Everywhere they at, they stole it. They're not supposed to be there.
So everyone talk about the GDs and Black Stones, but they don't talk about the Popes.
Nope. A play on?
Biggest gangsters. Original OG.
Murders related to a mafia blackmail scheme called the Black Hand. Victims would receive a letter imprinted with a drawing of a deadly hand. It was their signal to pay or die. A stern warning not to go to the police was also typically a part of the message. The isolated Italian victims, who often didn't speak English, complied. Many of these murders occurred in a tiny area named Death Corner. Physical conditions such as overcrowded, ramshackle buildings, dirty streets, and dark alleys also contributed to crime in the area. So with that in mind, local officials decided to bulldoze Little Hell during World War II, paving the way for a development called the Cabrini Green Public Housing Project. Chicago officials couldn't clear all 36 square miles, but in the early 1940s, they raised the core of Little Hell to build the Francis Cabrini Green Homes and made plans to take control of the surrounding area.
No, the time's 419. Go ahead.
Including Death Corner.
So we see that this is what was there prior to Cabrini Green and us being there. So get
try to go to total.
Malachi 1. Get Malachi 1 and 2. Just go straight to the point. Malachi 1 and 4. Malachi 1 and 4. So Little Hell preceded Cabrini Green that we know of today.
Malachi chapter 1, verse 4. Whereas Edom saith, we are impoverished, but we will return and build the desolate places.
Uh-huh.
Thus saith the Lord of hosts, they shall build, but I will throw down, and they shall call them the border of wickedness.
Esau is the border of wickedness. So prior, that's what Little Hell was, Little Hell, because it was them in there. It was them.
Bring it
they
out.
They had a corner called Death Corner. They had the black hand of death. And it was them that was murdering each other. The mob. It was them. So that means that it was a spirit already in that area.
Yep.
That was created by them.
Yeah.
It was their spirit that inhabited that early.
Yep.
Y'all know that's facts too. Y'all know the history of Al Capone.
Right.
You name it. All those mobsters that was here in the 20s during the Prohibition era, they was slaughtering each other. So they the ones kicked it off. So that ain't nothing that's just coming out of thin air. Go ahead, officer.
Go to Habakkuk 2 and 4. Habakkuk 2 and 4, because Esau the damn devil, just to say it plainly.
The devil.
They started the stuff, and then when we get there, that's when they want to highlight everything, put everything on the news, and put everything out there like it's all us. We understand we got issues and all of that, but we under the curses. We broke the commandments, and now we going through discipline. We going through a disciplinary action for turning against our God. They just wicked. Read.
Habakkuk chapter 2 and verse 4. Behold, his soul, which is lifted up, is not upright in him.
Their soul is not upright in them. And even after they bulldozed it and made Cabrini Greens, then they tried to put a facade on it and make it seem like they was creating it to better the area or whatever. Then they made it seem as if, but then they put us in there and let everything go to hell. Never fixed it. And then what would that create? We got low opportunities. No resources. What you think we're going to do?
Make crime.
It's going to create crime. So they tried to clean it up. They tried to clean their little hell up, put us in there to try to make us like we was worse than them. So go from there. Go to Tobit chapter 8 real quick. Because what we got to understand is Cabrini Green was how it was because the spirit that was there.
That's right.
There was a spirit that was there.
Prior to.
And it wasn't created by us.
Bring it out.
Because it was a spirit that was bound in that area. And just when we read this one scripture to show you that there's spirits that inhabit areas. So when you're in that area, that's what the spirit is going to be. So they moved the Italians out, moved us in, and now we exhibiting the same behaviors, but everything they want to highlight what we were doing, like as if they wasn't doing nothing before.
That kind of sound like every 4 years when they take out one person from the seat of presidency.
Yeah.
The next person with all of their claims claim to be different, but it's the same spirit.
Because it's a spirit in that seat.
It's a spirit in that seat.
Read. 8:3.
The book of Tobit, chapter 8 and verse 3. The witch smelled when the evil spirit had smelled. He fled into the utmost parts of Egypt, and the angel bound him.
So it shows here that's the evil spirit. To the next verse.
And after that, they were both shut in together. So Bias rose out of the bed and said, "Sister,
just read verse 3 again.
Verse 3?
Asmodeus. So you want me to just read verse 3. We're going to read the point.
Okay. The book of Tobit, chapter 8, and verse 3. The witch smelled when the evil spirit had smelled.
So this is an evil spirit. He smelled it. Read.
He fled into the utmost parts of Egypt.
Uh-huh.
And the angel bound him.
So the angel bound this spirit in Egypt. So this spirit was bound to Egypt, meaning that's what that spirit was. So that's what happened in that area. This is what we're reading about from Little Hill. It was a murderous spirit there. So when they erected the buildings of Cabrini again, that same evil spirit was there. I think one of y'all just mentioned they filmed Candyman. So that's the spirit that was there. So they put us there, and then that's what you had, the gang violence, we murdering and shooting, killing each other. That's what happened. It's a spirit there. So
Candyman kind of dressed like the Italians with that long-ass trench coat. Y'all remember that? Yeah. Where that come from?
Right. So let's play this next one, 7:35 to 10:13.
were subject to racial segregation. The CHA had been assigning tenants to the housing based upon their race, resulting in the concentration of African-American residents in isolated, segregated areas. Those apartment houses were considered well-built, attractive alternatives to the slums that traditionally housed low-income families, like the city's other public housing during that era. And I feel it's very important to note here, to emphasize, that even though Cabrini Green was once a model of successful public housing, poor planning, physical deterioration, and managerial neglect coupled with gang violence, drugs, and chronic unemployment turned the project into a national symbol of urban blight and failed housing policy. This would go down in history as being one of Chicago's most dangerous neighborhoods. In 1966, Dorothy Gautreau, an Altgeld Garden resident, filed a lawsuit against the Chicago Housing Authority. The Gautreau versus Chicago Housing Authority suit claimed that the actions of CHA violated the U.S. Constitution. The Supreme Court ruled in Gautreau's favor. This case prompted significant change within Chicago's public housing program, including the elimination of high-rise public housing construction and implementing programs that ensured new public housing development is scattered across the city. All the same, overwhelmed by the abundance of properties and lack of resources, the Chicago Housing Authority failed to make repairs and upkeep the public housing projects. In fact, for years, the neglect continued, causing the buildings to deteriorate and subjecting the tenants to poor living conditions, increased crime, and poverty. The superblocks left many areas of Chicago with row after row of monolithic concrete towers, artificially constructed communities cut off from neighbors around them, forming dense geographic concentrations of poverty. And as I'm sure anyone who grew up in Chicago or the surrounding suburbs would agree, the results would generally prove disastrous. The massive size of apartment complexes and a large number of residents made a sense of community and social order much harder to sustain. And with that, the project, which ultimately became known as Cabrini Green, became a national symbol of the deteriorating state of public housing in Chicago. In the following decades, despite various efforts to increase security, Cabrini Green became notorious for gangs, drugs, and sensational crime.
So we see, so read Jeremiah chapter 5, verse 23 through 26. Try to read it quick. Because all of what we just seen, that shows, it say gang violence, unemployment, all those conditions, all of those are conditions that will create an atmosphere where all we doing is trying to survive. We trying to survive, so we gonna rob, we gonna steal, we gonna kill, because it's every man for himself. Because that's the air, that's the environment that they created. But read that.
Jeremiah chapter 5 and verse 23.
Because at this time, there was churches, we was dancing and all of that crap, we was doing all of that. We was dancing and going to church, doing that, doing whatever. But read on, read that.
But this people hath a revolting and a rebellious heart. They are revolted and gone.
So this is us. This is us. We have a revolting and rebellious heart. Even though we was in the Christian churches, we was in the churches they were supposedly having as Bible, but we weren't doing nothing that the Bible said to do. And this is our parents. During this time, this was the parents. They was going to church. They was dragging their children in there. But the parents wasn't even doing what the Bible say to do.
Churches in that area.
Right. So read on.
Neither say they in their heart, let us now fear the Lord our God that giveth rain, both the former and the latter, in his season. He reserveth unto us the appointed weeks of the harvest.
So even at this time, we had no thought to actually do what God told us to do.
Right.
Our parents. Our grandparents, they didn't decide to do what God told them to do, so it created that atmosphere that we were living in that Cabrini Green, on top of the spirit that was already there. Read.
Verse 25, your iniquities have turned away these things, and your sins have withholden good things from you.
So no matter what, everything that's going on around us, what we have to learn and understand, these conditions existed because we was in the midst of sin. We turned our back on our God. That's the only way we was alive. Well, that was the only way we was able to be put in that position.
Right.
Because there's another scripture that says there's no enchantment against Jacob. Because then when we in our right mind, we keeping the commandments, you could put us anywhere. And that spirit that's in that area ain't going to affect us because we're keeping the commandments of God.
That's right.
And there's going to be people in the area that if you see somebody that do got that spirit on them, you're going to tell on them because the law tell you to tell on them.
Right.
But what was going on in these communities, because the people were scared, they wasn't saying nothing.
That's right.
Which is breaking further commandments so that the crime continue to increase and terrorize the community, which same thing goes on today. Read on.
Verse 26, for among my people are found wicked men.
Uh-huh.
They lay wait as he that setteth snares. They set a trap. They catch men.
This is what's going on in our community. This is what our people do. Play this next clip.
Unanticipated result of the steel fencing installed to secure the previously open gangways at Cabrini Green was that it became difficult for Chicago police officers to see through the steel mesh from the outside. On July the 17th, 1970, Chicago police patrolman Anthony N. Rosato and Sergeant James Severin were shot and killed by gang members while patrolling community housing for an all-volunteer walk and talk project. As the police officers proceeded across the Cabrini Green baseball field, the assailants opened fire from an apartment window. It was no accident. The shooting aimed to seal a pact between two rival gangs. Both officers were killed in the attack. Three adults and one juvenile were later charged with murder. The two shooters were sentenced to between 100 and 199 years in prison for two counts of murder. And the list of these types of situations goes on and on. For example, in 1981, the gang killing of 11 made national headlines, and hence something needed to change.
Go ahead.
Change.
I had
the U.S. Department of Housing and Urban Development is an administrative division.
Ezekiel 7:24. Because when I saw them statistics, I'm like, damn. These was the statistics for the crime for that housing complex. So because of the environment that was made, that was set up, what happened to that community? Not just Cabrini Green, all over during that time period. What happened to the places that we lived in? What did it become? Ezekiel 7:23.
The book of Ezekiel, chapter 7:23. Make a change, for the land is full of bloody crime.
What happened to our land, our communities we lived in?
For the land is full of bloody crime.
That's what you just saw. Full of bloody crime. Remember the spirit that was already put there by who? The Italians, the Swedes, the mobsters. And then we got there, that spirit hopped on our people. Read on.
And the city is full of violence.
It was a lot of murders during those time periods. You can look it up. Because what? The conditions, the environment that was made. That's it.
And those cops, they got killed. That was nothing but collateral damage.
Yep.
They wait till the SH got worse and try to bring up this reform to police the community, and they wind up getting killed by gang violence. That's all it is, collateral damage. And now it's put a deeper disdain on the housing projects, Cabrini Green, because that was mentioned in the previous article that the conditions there create a deep disdain for Cabrini Greens.
Yep. So right now, we're gonna skip a few things. Let's go to the commercials. Let's pull up them commercials.
Real quick, before we go to the commercials, Shalom. Most High Christ bless. Can you see me?
Let's get that camera.
Listen, while we're going on commercial break, I want you to look at this that's going across the screen, right? Donate. And also, hit that QR code. We have a mission to wake up our people. If you want to send watchmen all over the world to wake up their people, to wake up your people, donate. Hit that QR code, and while you're watching the commercial, go ahead and donate. But if you like staying here in captivity, don't donate anything. Just stay comfortable right there in your living room, watching from the sidelines.
Yeah.
But other than that, shalom.
Yep.
when you get back to your children, when you get back to your community, you still need to remember what happened. You need to remember what happened to Rasheem Carter. You need to remember what happened to Mike Brown. You need to remember what happened to Eric Gardner. You need to remember what happened to Emmett Till. You need to remember what happened to Medgar Evers. You need to remember what happened to Martin Luther King. You need to remember these things. Make it count. This is about us simply making our dollars work for ourselves.
A woman in Orlando was found hanging from a tree. Orlando police have said they believe she committed suicide.
But her family thinks that someone else is responsible for her death. West Houston Mike Brigadier explains why her loved ones and her.
Tonight, the Justice Department says it's assessing the deadly police shooting of Sonya Massey, the Illinois woman who called 911 about a possible prowler, only to be shot and killed by a sheriff's deputy in her own home.
The former deputy accused of killing a Springfield woman has pleaded not guilty to murder charges.
All of these men that you see came out of all kinds of walks of life, but the Bible has the solution to our people's problems. And when we organize up underneath the auspices of that Bible, that's when things come together. And the people need to see that. The people need to see that there is hope for them. The people, my sister needs to see that there's hope for her. All of the people in this community that's living under tyranny, living under fear, they need to see that. They need to understand that there is a power that is beyond the powers that be. And we need to follow him.
He that killeth with the sword must be killed with the sword. Here is the patience and the faith of the saints.
So all the nations going into slavery, 12 tribes, 12 tribes, 12 tribes.
Sons of thunder. It's the fourth time around. The fourth son of Jacob. And like 4 inches, you know we're going for it. Yeah. He come from the heaven with bombs. No, that ain't a lie, that's a legion. 144 came the way and they planned their allegiance to cremate the heathens. Damn, ashes to ashes and dust to dust. Had to pull out this flesh because I couldn't trust. Got a spiritual body, you couldn't touch it. If you die in the test, you try and look. That's the one up, don't run up, you done up. Loaded clip full of scripts, I'm a bullet. The word is my weapon, the word is my shield. I'm equipped for these spiritual bullets. They shoot at the perfect in secret. Reading these laws when they fall, so I keep it. Shout out to bishops and shout out to deacons. Captains and officers, I see the reason they say what we doing is treason. God, body, God, army, God, nation, my oblation, broken spirit, consecration, kings and priests, shining brighter than the constellation. Nukes to the north, yeah, that's abomination. For all the lies and the blaspheming, slay the dragon, hunt down the demons. Vagabond, get judgment, all looking at the judge.
Yo, Israel, the prince of the power. I came with an army, 144,000. We move like a unit, like Nike, just do it here. Them lions come to devour, and no weapon form gon' prosper. And we in the building like lava. Shout out to Deacon, can't tolerate treason. No me, Casa, Su Casa. Come to my city, better check in. Picked up my weight, get my sets in. We do not tolerate threats, man. Our angels activate, let's dance. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, and get done. How you gonna see when he block out the sun? Where you gonna hide? How you gonna run? Come with a cavalry, striving for mastery, praying for vengeance, a holy catastrophe. Build up the kingdom, yet that is the strategy. Get it in blood. America gone in 60 minutes. Yeah, it is finished, no necromancy. Build up my walls, that's expansion. Roll with the sun, many matches.
We rolling, we deeper than deep. The angels invisible, watch how they creep. I know I'm elite, I know I'm the seed. I'm bought with a price, they want the receipt. I tell them the Bible is all that I need. I pull it, they leave, they make like a tree. No chosen, I know that you're more like a beast. You roll over pride, but I roll with the meat. I don't need no naps, I don't need no sleep. Ain't selling no dope, but get changed on them streets. They conquer the west, I press to the east. Go pot with the Bible, extending my reach. Ain't toting no guns, but we got some range. Don't do it for dollars, we do it for change. Cut left from bleeding, the Bible, the aim. They called it a murder, cause doctor was slain.
Unprecedented events.
You are now flying.
S.O.T. Dream Team.
Let's go.
Fervent and heat. Let's go. Hey, hey, hey. Repeat after me. My G-O-D. He up top G. My precepts be on repeat.
Let's go.
Your past ain't messing with me. SOG. Tell Trump boy, we the elite. We gon' turn this shit upside down, make it hot. 144,000 degrees. I've been a prophet since birth. Angel sent back to the earth. My nation was sold. I know we the gold. Don't try me, boy. I know my worth. Like Adam came out of the dirt. Image of God, boy. I know that shit hurt. It's brick in the city. We still on the block and we putting in work. Purple and gold on my shirt. We never rest. We alert. Saturday, pull up the campus. Don't ask for your Sunday. We blessing the church. I'm about to murk all these scholars. Nigga, shut up. You getting this verse. He play with the fire. Ashes to ashes. He don't need a hearse. This is what the saints have been waiting for. The soundtrack to the end of the world. The symphony of destruction. If you're not ready, you better get ready. Let's go.
Everywhere I go, I see such sin. I can't pretend I must have spent. I will stand strong until the end. We the Israelites, we the Israelites. Everywhere I go, I see such sin. I can't pretend I must have spent. I will stand strong until the end. We the Israelites, we the Israelites.
Shalom. Reporting live straight out of Nazareth. They lied about our Christ, and I'm surprised you people having it. First he was immaculate, and now he doing magic tricks. If you can't see the signs, then I suggest you get your glasses fixed. Came looking for slaves, and then they said it was an accident. Taught him how to till the land, and then they called the savages. I can't be too mad what you expect from a bastard kid. He prone to lie, cause he ain't have a dad to whoop his ass for. Connect the scriptures so well, like 2 and 2 equals 12. The gates of hell should not prevail. Shout out to COINTEL. You in the midst of sin, repent or just get baked like a shell. I pop the clutch and hop the curb, you see I aim to excel.
Everywhere I go, I see such sin. I can't pretend I must defend. I will stand strong until the end. We the Israelites, tell it. We the Israelites. Everywhere I go, I see such sin. I can't pretend I must defend. I will stand strong until the end. We the Israelites, tell it. We the Israelites.
Look, to hell with the fame. Christ is coming to recompense all the blood of the slain. If your mind wrapped up in folly, then it's off with your brain. You think it's a game, just keep them same thoughts when the pain hits you, rip you, fire burning all through your tissue. You think it's that time of the month, the way blood is your issue. Judgment shortened to the point, like how you sign an initial. Covering off the blood of Christ, that's how you know it's official.
Everywhere I go, I see such sin. I can't pretend I must defend. I will stand strong until the end. Everywhere I go, I see such sin. I can't pretend I must defend. I will stand strong until the end. We the Israelites, tell it. We the Israelites.
Shalom, shalom, shalom. Most High in Christ. Blessed. We back at it. Watching
back
radio.
That's right.
That's right.
So we're going to go into our next segment of local Chicago news. What's going on in Chicago, right? Henceforth, we're going into Chicago news. But henceforth, nonetheless, the same thing that's going on in Chicago is trust and belief is going on in every inner city in the globe and the planet. Let's get the first article, please. All right, let's read that. We're not going to play the video, but just read it. Scroll up. Let's go on to the world local news. Uh-oh, it's not looking good. We got 3 mug shots, by the way. So you can tell these are not honorable citizens, by the way. But can we see the words? If not, let's play the video. Scroll back up. I think those words are too small for my reader. Let's play that.
In Egypt to make sure the deal is done by their side, because in the end we have here Hirsch, which
I don't think that's it. That's a live view. It's not pertaining to the article.
Can you zoom it in?
Yeah, zoom in so we can read the words, please.
Right above the mug shots.
Yeah.
Read that, Cicero, Illinois.
Cicero, Illinois. Three Cook County men have been charged in connection with a midday crime spree earlier this year. Demetrius Bowens, 28, Octavius T. Crockett, 32, both of Chicago, and Joseph Wilson, 27, of Park Forest, have all been charged with multiple counts of armed robbery.
Counts.
Multiple counts of armed robbery and aggravated vehicular hijacking, according to a statement from the Cicero Police Department.
So these three brothers was on a major crime spree, right? What in their right mind think they was going to get away with it, right?
They Jake.
Read on.
On April 25th, officers responded to two armed robberies.
Oh, I know what it is. They watched too many Al Capone films, right?
There you go.
The hell is this?
There you go.
That same spirit. Read.
In the area of 1800 South 50th Court and 5100 West 30th Street, as well as two carjackings near 1600 South 48th Court and 2800 South 50th Court. All four incidents happened between 11:42 a.m. and 12:13 p.m., the statement said.
That's within 30 minutes. Four crimes within 30 minutes. They wasn't going to stop.
Wow. No, they wasn't going to stop.
But on the bright side, at least these brothers didn't get gunned down by the police, you know what I mean? So, but I can't help that out of these three brothers, did no one come to their mind or try to think like, man, should I be doing this? Is this right? But for you out there that's thinking about committing crimes or thinking about having a major crime spree, right? Let's go to Proverbs chapter 1. Proverbs chapter 1, I believe, verse 8. I'm not even there. Let's go there.
Proverbs chapter 1.
Hold on. Let me get it. That's verse 10.
Proverbs chapter 1, verse 10.
Because what does God say about this, right? These brothers were on a major crime spree. Four crimes within a half an hour. What is that? A crime every 8 minutes?
Yeah.
Read that.
My son, if sinners entice thee, consent not. Consent thou not.
So it says, my son, if sinners entice thee, so because these brothers are in the midst of sin. So if anyone try to convince you all to commit crimes, what the Bible say?
Consent thou not.
Don't do it because you go get caught up like this. You go be on the local news mugshot, just like these brothers. Put the shame, caught red-handed, literally. So,
and that's not the worst of it, being put on display, because they live for this notoriety or this infamy.
Right.
They don't care. As long as you can see them, that's all they care about. You should care about what the Lord thinks, about how the Lord sees you. Now, the problem with what's going on here is them brothers going to jail.
Right.
Who knows how long they're going to be in jail? These brothers exposed themselves to be killed by the police.
Mm-hmm.
That's that self-destructive behavior that we have to put a stop to.
Let's read that verse again. The sentence entice thee.
My son, if sinners entice thee, consent thou not.
So if you're not willing to do the time, do not do the crime. Don't consent to peer pressure. Don't consent to committing crimes, family.
Hey, you ain't gonna get caught.
Right.
Hey, you're a juvenile. They ain't gonna give you a slap on the wrist.
Right.
That's that enticing. They making it sweet for you to do it.
I blame it on the rap music, man.
Wow. Bring it out.
So we could drop this. Let's go to the next one. What's going on in local news, right?
Bring it out.
So again, if you can't do the time, don't do the crime, Israel. What's going on? Next article, please. What's going on? This is not it.
While we looking for the video, can I get a precept?
Oh, yeah.
Let me get Leviticus chapter 18. Because earlier the officer was bringing out about how little hell was raised, right? How little hell was destroyed, how the spirit is actually bound to different areas. And in Chicago, we understand that we have a murderous spirit here that dwells here, and it infects the people that lives here. The Lord tried to warn us beforehand, telling us, be mindful of where you're going. Be mindful of the land that you're going to inhabit. Why is he saying that? Because in his infinite wisdom, he know he bound certain spirits in certain locations. Can I get 18 and verse 24?
Leviticus chapter 18 and verse 24.
Kind of read it a little quickly.
Defile not ye yourselves in any of these things, for in all these nations are defiled.
For in all these the nations are defiled, right? Go ahead.
For in all these the nations are defiled, which I cast out before you.
You hear that? Nations were cast out before the children of Israel for doing the abominable things mentioned earlier in the verse, which is sin. So the Lord is trying to tell the children of Israel, don't sin. If you do so, guess what's going to happen? You're going to lose your apartment. You're going to lose the property in which you actually sit upon. If you don't tell about the crime that's going on around your neighborhood, guess what's going to happen? The property value is going to plummet, and nobody's going to want to invest in your area, and your area is going to look like hell. There's going to be a lot of drug abuse, a lot of drug addiction, a lot of drug selling, a lot of people hanging out on the corners of your neighborhood, and they probably don't even live there, making it harder for you. So the Lord's telling you to keep the commandments. If not, you're going to get moved off the land. And now where's Cabrini Green? Where's the majority of the projects?
Yep. Exactly.
Where they at? They're gone. The people that lived there, gone, just like the nation that was there before them. I wanted to just touch on that real quick.
All praise. Let's go to the next. Let's go to the clip of local news in Chicago. What's going on?
Bring it out.
It's a loss that certainly hits close to home for Pastor Corey Brooks, who has spent years in Chicago across so many different communities trying to end gun violence just like this. He says his 21-year-old godson was a good kid playing college sports. Now the family, desperate for answers, and the death of Christian Tucker.
This is our 21-year-old son. Great kid, A student, sports in college. Just a tough situation.
Christian Tucker was waiting in his car near 72nd and Washtenaw Saturday evening when Chicago police say someone shot him multiple times. Police say the 21-year-old was pronounced dead after they arrived on scene. That's when Pastor Corey Brooks got a call about his godson.
When it happens to you and it happens to people who are close to you, it even makes you know and understand that there's still a lot of work to do, even more so. And we're going to do everything we can to continue to help this family.
Brooks says Tucker was a young man with a bright future ahead of him as he was playing basketball at a junior college, preparing to make the jump.
Let's pause that, right? Because we got this brother, this pastor, his godson was gunned down, right? Our heart goes out to the family, right? These are things that we go out to preach about. We preach about the crime and the violence in the city, right? But I can't help that this brother is a pastor, right? As a pastor, he should understand why these things are taking place, right? I understand that our people, they try to take avenues to bring down the crime and bring down the awareness. But as a pastor, you should already be understanding why these things are happening. Let's go to Malachi 2 and verse 7, right? Let's go there. This is for all you pastors out there. This is what you need to understand right here. Because if you understand this, then yes, you could bring down, you can help deter the crime, right? Let's get that Malachi 2 and verse 7.
The book of Malachi chapter 2 and verse 7. For the priest's lips should keep knowledge.
So the priest's lips should keep knowledge, right? This pastor should have some understanding, some knowledge, right? Read.
And they should seek the law at his mouth.
So that's the problem with these pastors. They don't seek after God's laws. Thou shalt not kill. Thou shalt not steal, right? Hell, these pastors, they be knowing what's going on in these neighborhoods that they preach in. But what are they doing in these neighborhoods, right? Again, our heart goes out to his family, but if this brother, this pastor was out here preaching God's word, preaching the laws, this would be very, I believe this would go very different. His godson would still be alive today. I believe so.
Yeah, and I want to bring something out because a lot of times in situations like this, you have a lot of our people will have their sons, they have good grades.
Right.
Like they said in this, he had good grades, he played basketball. He had a good life set out for him where he was a good kid. And he actually probably was a good kid. Can't say that he wasn't. We can't say that he was involved in gangs. But one thing that happens within our community, because we are away from God's laws, a good kid like that could have been messing with a sister that was involved with some street nigga. And that street Negro could have found out. And when he caught him, he seen him, drove past, whatever the case may be, he shot him down over it. Right. That's what, and I'm not saying that's what happened in this situation, but that could be, those are things that happen in our neighborhood because we so far pulled away, we so far removed from the commandments of God. Get Proverbs chapter 6 and 32. We so far removed from God's laws that these are things that happen within our neighborhoods that be a result of some of the shootings, because some of the shootings do be somebody that's quote unquote a good kid in the eyesight of the world, that they're not in gangs, and the parent know that they're not in gangs. But a lot of times, our young men get caught up with a woman that they shouldn't have been messing with. But read that.
Proverbs chapter 6 and verse 32. But whoso committeth adultery with a woman lacketh understanding.
Uh-huh.
He that doeth it destroyeth his own soul.
So this is on a spiritual level. You commit adultery with a woman, you sleep with a woman that's not your wife, you going sleeping around, you destroying your soul, because ultimately the payment for that is eternal death beyond this physical body. But read on.
A wound and dishonor shall he get, and his reproach shall not be wiped away.
Read.
For jealousy is the rage of a man. Therefore, he will not spare in the day of vengeance.
So now we know in the it says adultery. So it's talking about someone that's married.
Right.
You commit adultery, you either stepped out on your wife or you slept with somebody else's wife. But it says in the results of that, it says jealousy is the rage of a man. When a person is enraged, that means they're extremely angry and they're gonna murder you because they feel like you crossed them.
Right.
And that's what happens in our communities. Not saying that this is what happened to the brother. And of course, the condolences and things go out to the family. We're not speaking against this brother, but these are the things that happen in our community on a day-to-day basis.
Exactly.
As a result of messing with the wrong woman or whatever the case may be. You may have something may have happened at school where he bumped into the wrong person, said a few words, and he just went about his way, not thinking nothing of it, and then that person seen him out on the street and murdered him in cold blood, senseless killing.
Exactly. So on the surface, there's a lack of God's laws being taught in our communities and our churches. So let's continue the article. Continue with the video clip. Play on.
Your university, the family, now offering a $10,000 reward for any information leading to an arrest.
He was just waiting in the car and someone just took his life. But he wasn't a bad kid. He wasn't in a gang. He wasn't a kid running around doing mischievous stuff. He was a really, really good kid.
Police say they're still investigating the circumstances surrounding the shooting.
So again, back to Malachi 2:7, the priest's lips should keep knowledge, right? Because I could tell that the pastor's hurting, but he don't have no answers. He don't understand why these things are happening. Because had he did, he would have went on there and explained, okay, man, we got to keep God's laws. Stop the killing. Stop the hatred among our brothers. It's always the same story. He was a good kid. How about let's get to the solutions? Let's find out. How about why these things keep happening? If you're a pastor, if you have knowledge that the Bible states that you should have.
Hey, Officer Aria, before we leave this, Matthew 23 and verse 24 and 12. Real quick, because we hear the lifestyle that the young man had.
Right.
He wasn't your typical, but he was targeted by somebody and murdered. Why is that? The lack of God's commandments.
Right.
Because we are not taught God's commandments, how do we deal with one another in this city, Chicago, that we're talking about? What is the mannerism? How do we deal with one another? How do we treat one another? Read that.
The book of Matthew, chapter 24 and verse 12.
Those of you who live here, you know that. This is the, I'm going to use a plain word for you. This is the vibe in this city. Read.
And because iniquity shall abound.
Because iniquity, which is sin, will increase. It will be a lot. Here's another plain word. Crime. Crime will increase. Read.
The love of many she'll wax cold.
Right. No remorse, no empathy, no sympathy, no mercy. You will see senseless killings. You don't got to be in the game to be murdered like that. God's laws is not taught, so we live in a lawless society. So we need God's laws. Go ahead, Austin.
So that will conclude what's going on in the local news. Now we're about to move on to world/global news. What's going on in the world today? Read that, reader.
15 Islamic State group fighters dead. At least 6 U.S. soldiers injured in raid on terror group in Iraq.
Oh, man, so we back in Iraq again, huh? Some of y'all might have thought that the Operation Restore Freedom was over with. We still there. We still in the Middle East. Read on.
The injuries to U.S. soldiers included possible cases of traumatic brain injury and at least one external injury. The U.S. raid took place in Anbar.
Swipe down. We're just going to read.
A U.S. military operation Thursday in Iraq killed at least 15 Islamic State militant group fighters. And at least 6 U.S. soldiers suffered injuries, 3 U.S. defense officials said.
I don't know, man. Every time I read these articles, right, you always hear the casualties on the opposite side. But when it comes to our people, no one was injured. It makes you wonder. That makes no sense, right?
Right.
Wait a minute. Say that again. What did you say?
As far as like when America has conflicts.
Not our.
What'd I say?
Oh. You said our people.
They
never show the casualties of our people. You being American now?
Hell no. You got to edit that, BT, edit that. But nonetheless, right, the point is, when it comes to U.S. Conflict going on worldwide, they always go into the opposing casualties on the opposing end. But when it comes to American casualties, no one's hurt.
Right.
That was the point I was making. Read on.
None of the injuries to the U.S. soldiers were described as life-threatening. Several were possible traumatic brain injuries, and at least one soldier suffered external injuries.
So let's get some understanding about the Arabs, right? Because Iraq, those are the Arabs over there, right? Let's go into the nature of the Arabs, right? Because let's understand who they really are according to the Bible. Let's understand their nature, because as long as America is over there in the Middle East, it will never be no peace over there.
Right.
Let's go to 16, Genesis chapter 16.
The book of Genesis chapter 16, verse 11.
What'd that say?
And the angel of the Lord said unto her, behold, thou art with child, and shalt bear a son, and shalt call his name Ishmael.
Uh-huh.
Because the Lord hath heard thy affliction.
Because Ishmael, those are the Arabs today, Ishmael. They come from the lineage of Ishmael. Those are Arabs. So let's go into the nature of them.
And he will be a wild man. His hand will be against every man, and every man's hand against him. And he shall dwell in the presence of all his brethren.
Right, that's why you have all them in the Middle East right there, grouped up in the Middle East and North region Africa, right? He said he's a wild man. How wild? Wild to the point that they would strap C4 to their chest in the name of Allah Akbar. That's how wild he is. And it said that, read that again. He will be against every what?
And his hand will be against every man, and every man's hand against him.
That's why the Arabs, they have terrorism throughout the whole world, whether it be in Europe, Russia, even over here in America, it's always counted as terrorist attacks, right? He's against every man, and every man is against him. So this is the nature of Ishmael. So Ishmael is going to... That's his nature right there, right? Read on. Let's finish the article.
None of the injuries to the U.S. soldiers were described as life-threatening. Several were possible traumatic brain injuries, and at least one soldier suffered external injuries, the defense officials said.
Right, because you hear across the news that America is involved in every conflict worldwide, right? They in Europe. They involved in Ukraine. They involved in Israel, right? Now they back in Iraq, right? What does the Bible say about this, right? This man right here, America. That too. He is the devil. Let's go to Habakkuk 2:5. Let's find out. Habakkuk chapter 2 and verse 5. Habakkuk chapter 2 and verse 5. So we understand that Ishmael is a wild man, right? Why is America still over there in Iraq? Why are they anywhere throughout the planet? Read Habakkuk 2 and 5. Habakkuk chapter 2, verse 5.
Habakkuk chapter 2, and verse 5. Yea, also because he transgresseth by wine.
So this is talking about the United States of America. He transgressed by wine what? His policies. Right? Read on.
He is a proud man.
Uh-huh.
Neither keepeth at home.
See that? Neither keep at home. That's why he's all over the planet. He has over 800 bases worldwide. That's why he's still in Iraq right now. Read.
Who enlargeth his desire as hell and is as death and cannot be satisfied.
So America cannot be satisfied, right? America is like hell because everywhere they go throughout the world, through their policies and their diplomacy, hell follows it. Hell follows it. So let's go back to the article, right? Let's go back there to the operation took place. Where did it take place?
The operation took place Thursday in Anbar in western Iraq, the official said. Some of the dead ISIS figures were in leadership.
ISIS members, right? So go scroll back up to the article. Scroll back up, scroll back up. Scroll back up. So that Islamic State, those are ISIS fighters, right? ISIS fighters. So that concludes our world news. All right, all right. Keep it rolling, keep it rolling. Let's go to our Black History segment. Black facts you didn't know, Jack.
In 1966, Marie Van Britten Brown and her husband, Albert Brown, invented a home security system that included television surveillance. The item also had microphones to communicate with the person at the door of the home and a button to contact the police. They filed for a patent in 1966, and it was approved in 1969. They hoped big companies or home manufacturers would be interested, but building them was too expensive. The patent has been cited on 38 patent applications over the years, meaning 38 inventors have made items similar to the Browns' initial invention. Notable black figures you've never heard of.
That's it, that's it. So, wow. So, what we just found out today?
We made the Ring camera?
Yes.
Basically.
ADT, all that.
That's us.
Security systems.
Damn.
And a button, and an intercom system, and a button to call the police.
That's high tech for 1969.
Right, but we don't hear about these things. Our sister Marie Van Britten Brown and Albert L. Brown, creator of the home security system that we know today.
That's what's up.
Some of those same Bean cameras. I think they have like a social media page, a following where they upload all those Bean videos, and you get to see crazy stuff like porch pirates,
or people falling down the stairs.
Yeah, also Abel. Oh yeah, right.
Damn. We got the sore sound. What a punch.
Right. Get to see all type of stuff being exposed.
Yeah.
All praises, man.
You catch crimes on those things. Yep. A lot of times porch pirates are captured because they going on to your porch and stealing your package. And the Ring camera's capturing it.
You see little chihuahua sinking at them, biting them at the ankles, all that. Man. All type of funnies. Oh, all man. Type of bloopers.
Oh, man.
All because of our brothers and sister right here. All praises. And that's your black facts you didn't know, Jack.
That's right.
All praises to the Most High. So that's going to conclude the radio show for today. We hope that you were edified, that you learned something, that you picked up something new. And most of all, we hope that you learned that you were an Israelite and that you learned to repent, that you contact us. But with that, we're going to conclude the show. I'm Officer Makaya.
Officer Asa.
I'm Officer Yogananda directing you to the bottom of the screen to donate to our cause. Hit the QR code.
and Officer Ariel.
Most High Christ bless.
Support.
Most High Christ bless.
Oh, praise.
Hebrews 13:17, prophets on the scene, wash your souls clean before we go into the gasoline. Took a while to understand, Psalms 111:10, brother calling me from Mississippi trying to build a man. I flushed 14 grams, it made angels rejoice, it made me and Satan divorce, no spouse support. I'm running the course with my hand to the plow,
now
putting in the pebble the way Soldier James taught me how.
Break it out,
it strengthened my spirit when we in the building. Ain't no feeling like giving the precept for a precept giving.
Preach.
MOV conditions.
Teach.
7 second living.
We.
2 Timothy 2:15. Representatives.
Jeez.
World of common interest. Prophesy to the wind. Rebuild the man of sin. Enduring to the end.
We watchmen for Israel. Cause we watch it for Israel. We the watchmen for Israel. Cause we watch it for Israel. We the watchmen for Israel. Cause we watch it for Israel. We the watchmen for Israel. Cause we watch it for Israel. We the watchmen for Israel, cause we watch it for Israel. We the watchmen for Israel, cause we watch it for Israel. We the watchmen for Israel, cause we watch it for Israel. We the watchmen for